Okay, so let's get started. All right, can everyone hear me? Okay, so this is lecture 20 of Computer Science 162. So today, we're gonna learn about why systems fail and some of the techniques that we can use at the hardware level and at the software level to fix the systems. Okay, so goals. First goal is to define what is fault tolerance. Second goal that we want to talk about is what are some of the causes of system failures. And then we're going to look at a variety of different approaches, both at work at the hardware level and the software level. And we'll look at what happens in data centers, in the cloud, and finally geographic diversity as a technique. Now, Leslie Lamport's a famous computer scientist. And he has this quote that's one of my favorite quotes, which is, you know you have a distributed system when the crash of a computer you've never heard of stops you from getting any work done. Right? And this happens to all of us every day. You go to, look at something on Facebook, and you get an error. Right? Why is the error occurring? Could be a DNS issue, could be a networking issue, could be a problem at Facebook. Many different things could have gone wrong. Okay, so to talk about fault tolerance, we have to talk about the three E-I-T-s, integrity and reliability, availability, and security. Security is the next two lectures. That's kind of why that piece of the pie is pulled out. So reliability or integrity is that your system does the right thing. Okay, so I go to withdraw $50 out of my bank account, and the system correctly debits my account for $50 and gives me $50. Incorrect would be perhaps it debits $50 and nothing comes out of the machine. Now, in order to have reliability and integrity, we have to have a very large mean time between failure. So that's the average time between when something's working and when it's no longer working. Availability means it does it now. The system might correctly be capable of taking $50, debiting it, and giving me $50, but if the ATM's not working, it's not very available. And so it means right now, when I'm standing there in front of the computer. So for that, we need to have a small mean time to repair. So when it breaks, how quickly can you fix it? And that's it's a function of that over the mean time between failures plus the mean time to repair. Right, so we want very large mean time between failure, very small mean time to repair. Now it gets more complicated in reality, right? So if I'm just sitting in front of my computer, I can ask that reliability question, I can ask that availability question. But when I go up to the ATM may be just one of thousands or tens of thousands of hundreds of thousands of terminals that the bank has. So this gets into the question of system availability. You know, what does it mean if 90% of my ATMs are up and 99% of my database is up? Right? Does that mean that 89% of the transactions are serviced on time? Not quite, right? You've probably all encountered this, right? You call up the bank on a Sunday and because you need to talk about your credit card bill or something like that, and they tell you, oh, I'm sorry, the database for your account is down for servicing. Right? So everybody else is able to use the bank, but you're not able to. So from your point of view, that is unavailability, but the bank would probably say, no, we're up and available, because for 90% of our customers, they can do something right now, or whatever, 99% if it's the database. So this is where it gets kind of tricky and people will play numbers. Right? Google will have an outage, Apple will have an outage, Microsoft will have an outage, but they'll say, oh, it only affected 0.04% of our customers. If you're one of those customers who doesn't have email for 2 days, it's an outage. Right? But for the other 99.96% of the customers, it's not. So this is how people will typically play games with fault tolerance. Okay, so mean time to repair is something we need to talk about. This is really critical Because, you know, everybody always thinks about the mean time between failure. You buy a disk drive, what's the mean time between failure of the disk drive? Buy a computer, you know, what's the mean time between failure? But the mean time to repair is equally important, as we saw in terms of availability. So the mean time to repair when you have an outage, first you have to realize that it's broken. Now, this can be because angry customers start emailing you or start sending tweets about your service. That might be how you discover it. Probably not a good way. You want to have good logging, good monitoring within your system to detect that something's gone wrong. Then you have to actually diagnose it. And so here's where documentation comes into play and really having good operations people comes into play. So, you know, one of the reasons why we push you to write documentation is because when you graduate from here and you're writing code in the real world, it's likely you're not going to be the person who's dealing with that code on an operational basis. Some other team or group of people is going to be dealing with it. And they're not the Uber hackers that you guys are. And so they need to understand very quickly in the middle of the night what's gone wrong with your code. Because otherwise, they're going to call you and wake you up, make you come in. So, and you know, when we, you know, if you look at outages, especially in the cloud, a lot of these outages occur during changes. It's the operations team that's making the change based on some engineering code that's been developed by the engineers, and things go wrong. Right? And without good documentation, it can take a long time to diagnose what's wrong. And then you need to decide what you're going to do. Right? So we talked about databases. Salesforce is a company that maintains a single physical database with a single schema that on top of that they put all the logical customers. There are hundreds of thousands of customers. And periodically, they decide to change that physical schema. And so now they have to take terabytes of customer data and convert it from one database schema to another. It's a really scary process. Because if something fails in the middle of that, they're either faced with trying to push forward and correct whatever the error is, or to go back to their backups, in which case it takes several days to restore from backup. So having a very good process for making that decision of, are we going to push forward and continue this migration, or are we going to go and have a multi-day outage while we restore is important. And again, you know, lots of examples of cloud outages where, you know, the time to decide what to do actually ended up costing quite a bit of time as part of the outage. And bad decisions made caused the outage to be longer. And then you actually have to act. So once you've come up with a plan of what you're going to do to repair, you actually have to act on it. Okay, so there's a big difference between, and you know, now that we've entered hurricane season, it's probably kind of quite apropos. There's a big difference between fault tolerance, where you might be trying to mask local faults within a system, and you can do that with redundant hardware or redundant software, redundant array of inexpensive disks, uninterruptible power supplies, you know, big, large batteries that can run you for 15 minutes or more, or failing over between multiple clusters within a data center. There's a big difference between that kind of fault tolerance and what happens when Hurricane Sandy hits, right? And then your data center floods or gets washed away. You know, many of the companies that are based in New York City had a big problem because, you know, their data center might have been up on the 20th floor, but their generators were in the basement. And when the water came in and flooded, the power went out. Or in some cases, actually, their generators were up on the roof, but their tanks were in the basement. And so they had little bucket brigades going up and down the stairs trying to feed the generators. So disaster tolerance is what masks an entire site failure. So when you have a fire or flood or sabotage, or most recently, when we have a power outage on campus. Right? It took down all of our data centers. But there was still a website that you could go to find out what was going on. It was emergency.berkeley.edu. Because that website isn't hosted on a machine on campus. It's hosted on a machine in a remote data center. Specifically because the last time we had a campus-wide power outage, there was no way to find out what was going on campus. The other thing that you can do is use design diversity. So this is a technique where, you know, for example, you might use different versions of Linux. So that way, if there's a particular bug or a fault that affects Linux, it won't affect your implementation of it. It'll just take down some of your machines. All right, so these are some of the base definitions. Another very important definition is what we mean by system availability. And so now when I talk about system availability, I mean that a customer can use the system. Again, it doesn't mean that all customers necessarily can use the system. So this is divided up into availability classes. They call them nines, based on the number of nines that you have in this percent availability column. So the first one is one nine. So that means 90% of the time, your system is available. That seems like a really good number, right? 90%, that's a lot. That's more than most of the time. It's 90% of the time your system is available. Let's look at it the other way around, which is how much unavailability does this translate into? So 90% on a yearly basis translates into what in terms of downtime per year? An entire month, right? 36 days. So this is, you know, this is your bank that says, you know, our systems are down for maintenance, you know, roughly, you know, two-thirds of the, you know, Sundays a year. Right? So you can't do anything with your account for that Sunday. Translates into 72 hours a month and translates into two business days a week. That's a lot. Question? Yeah, so that gets to a very important, that's a very important question. So there's a difference, the question is about the difference between scheduled and unscheduled, and you know, do you always use your scheduled maintenance? So absolutely, everybody plays the game of not counting scheduled maintenance as part of your unavailability, right? Because it's scheduled. You know? It's not a bug if it's documented, it's a feature. The second part of this is, absolutely, it's good to have a regular maintenance window, even if you don't actually use it, right? Because again, that way you avoid unplanned outages or unscheduled kinds of outages. Okay, so two nines. That sounds like it'd be a lot better, and it is. Now we're down to 3 2/3 of a day per year, 7 hours a month, and an hour and two-thirds per week. So we're getting better. And we add another nine, now we're down to less than a business, a little over a business day per year, 43 minutes a month, and 10 minutes per week. And it just gets better, right? By the time we get to six nines, we're at 32 seconds of downtime for an entire year, right? And 3 seconds in a month, and 2/3 of a second in a week. So everyone would love to be, their goal is, you know, class six. In practice, they don't quite hit it. Okay? So Google, you know, Gmail, which is our campus email provider, Microsoft's hosted Exchange, they target three nines of unscheduled outages. So they will occasionally have scheduled outages where they'll give you advance warning, we're going to have a downtime during this period. Now, do they actually hit that? Yeah, pretty much. So Gmail in 2010 hit 99.98, so they almost got to four nines. Microsoft doesn't publish an exact number, but just says it was over 99.9. So again, that's not a lot of outage time. But you know, even an eight-hour outage, that's going to make the national news for a company like Microsoft or Google. And again, you know, the way to think about this is unavailability, it's proportional to the mean time to repair over the mean time between failure plus the mean time to repair. So if we can reduce the time it takes to recover from a failure, or we can increase the time between failures, we'll drive down the unavailability. All right, so what causes systems to be unavailable? Lots of factors. So this is from a report that analyzed enterprise IT systems. And they found a bunch of different things. Lack of best practices for things like change control. Right, so again, this is the reason why we want you to use CVS, or not CVS, version control, is because we want you to be able to go back and see when, you know, your code was working at 2 a.m. and now it's not working at 4 a.m. and you can't remember what happened in the last 2 hours. Well, with version control, you know, you can look and see exactly what changed. Lack of monitoring. The largest telephone outage in the United States at a time, this was about 15 years ago, at a time when there was roughly 180 million long-distance telephone calls a day, was caused by lack of monitoring of a phone switch that had gone onto battery backup at AT&T. And then a ripple effect that took down all of AT&T's long-distance network. So monitoring is critical. Requirements and procurement, operations. We'll look at a few examples of operations gone wrong. External failures in the network, application failures, and external services. Anytime you're dependent on a third party, it's good to have two providers, because if one goes down, you can switch to the other one. The physical environment and network redundancy, backup. You know, the technical solution that you use for backup and the actual process that you use for backup. So how many people here back up their computer? Okay, I'm gonna have a graph that'll scare you in a little while if you don't back up. How many people who back up actually check their backups periodically by restoring a file? Whoa. See, it's not good just to have a backup, because the backup, you might be recording garbage. And you laugh, but I've seen many cases where someone went to go and restore a file from the backup, and the backups were corrupted. And companies also have had this problem. So not only is it important to backup, and again, you know, if you're saying, well, you know, I just keep everything in Box, or I keep everything in Dropbox, you know, you want to have multiple. So if you're going to store it in your Berkeley Box account, also store it in a Dropbox account at the same time. Physical location and infrastructure redundancy, and then storage architecture redundancy is another big problem. So Jim Gray, when he was at Tandem Nonstop Computers, did a survey of failures in Tandem systems. Now, Tandem Nonstop has since been purchased by HP, and these are the computers that power NASDAQ and the New York Stock Exchange and some large financial institutions and also airlines and places like that. So these are businesses where every minute of downtime is millions to hundreds of millions of lost dollars in revenue, and is also lost confidence, right? When NASDAQ has a computer problem, like when Facebook IPO'd or a year later they had a problem, everybody hears about it, everybody knows about it, and that makes people rethink whether they should be in the NASDAQ market or they should be in the New York Stock Exchange or one of the other markets. So any kind of downtime in these systems is absolutely unacceptable. So in 1985, he looked at their uptime. And so here's a graph of for 3 different years of the mean time between failures in years. And most of these numbers look really good, except for the total. The system as a whole had a mean time between failure of 8 years. Again, 8 years, that seems awesome. Right? That seems like a huge number. But not when you're a market that moves hundreds of billions of dollars a year. A day, rather. Right? That's not acceptable. You want more like a 10, 20, 30-year mean time between failure. Biggest cause? Software. The operating system software. And second was hardware. So what did they do? They doubled down, and they went through all of the operating system software and made it as bulletproof as possible. Yep. Didn't that sound familiar from Project 2? You bulletproof your OS. And there's a reason why we use this as an example. And also on the hardware. So spending ridiculous amounts. So they built hardware. You know, why build one when you can build two? Or you can build three? Or you can build four? Right? So don't have one CPU running. Have four CPUs that are doing the exact same thing. So again, it's worth it to the customers to have everything be totally bulletproof, because downtime's not acceptable. So 2 years later, look at this, they had more than doubled, almost tripled the overall system mean time between failure by looking at every single thing and trying to, you know, beef up the environment. So this is better power conditioning, better UPS, better generator, better operations. I'll go over a classic example that Jim Gray used of an operations failure. Maintenance, you know, preventative maintenance is really good, but you need really good logging and analysis of those logs in order to do preventative maintenance and prevent outages. So what did the stock market do right before Twitter went public? They did a dry run to see what would happen, simulated against their systems of high load, because they wanted to make sure their systems could handle the load of Twitter going public, unlike what happened with Facebook going public. So hardware, became three times more reliable. And software, more than an order of magnitude gain. So this was great. Tandem could, parade these numbers around. And then, 3 years later, suddenly operations had declined and software had declined. So what do you think happened on the software side? Right, they'd gotten this code so bulletproof, and then all of a sudden, it almost lost half of its reliability. What's that? Any ideas? Software is never static. You always have new features. And every time you introduce a new feature, you introduce a new bug. Or probably actually you introduce a bunch of new bugs. So, they spent all this time bulletproofing, but they had to freeze the operating system to do that. Once they got it bulletproof, then it's like, okay, let's add our features in. They added in the features, and reliability went down. Okay? So you kind of have to, again, look at the entire system and, be aware that there's this sort of tension, especially as an engineer, that you're going to get of, management is going to be saying, this has to be bulletproof, it has to be super reliable. Oh, and here's a list of 200 changes that we want you to make by the end of next week. Yes? So the question is, how do we have a mean time between failure for software and an overall system mean time between failure of 8 years? So this is looking at all the different distributions, the Gaussian distributions of each of the mean times between failures, and then doing the probability of a failure per year. So the question is, will it be worse because software is going to fail every 2 years? So software, again, this is a distribution, so not all systems will fail, have a software bug, right? Some systems might run for 10 years without hitting that particular software bug while, a disk drive dies and brings the whole system down. Okay, so it's not just the floor, it's not the minimum that causes a failure, it's, one of these failures occurring in a particular system. Okay, so one of the big areas of, question in the back? Yeah, so one of the things, the question is, how do they calculate the mean time between failures, because some of these numbers are much longer than computers have been in existence. So there's a couple of problems. They look at the error reports that are coming in, and the distribution of those error reports over time, and use that to derive an estimated mean time between failures. So these are all estimated mean time between failures. These are not based on observing the data. And I'll give you an example of how we can do something similar today with disk drives in just a moment. The other issue here is that not all errors get reported. So some of this is automated, some of this is manual reporting, especially on the operations side, and so there is some underreporting that occurs. So these numbers are a little bit higher than they may be in reality. So one case that Jim Gray liked to use was a very classic operations failure. So I mentioned backups. Here is a small business network-attached storage device. So it has four drive bays, and you can put 2-3 terabyte drives in them, and it uses RAID. So you have one of these in your business. and up pops a console alert, or you get an email message or something like that saying, RAID drive 1 has failed. Replace immediately. Okay, we want to replace it immediately because meantime to repair. Right? If we suffer another drive failure before we're able to replace repair this drive, we'll lose all our data because these RAID arrays with four drives can tolerate a single drive failure. You know, RAID 5, for example. Okay, so operations guy comes along. He's got his little tray of drives with him. So he pulls the drive and the array dies. So what went wrong here? Any ideas? Yeah. Ah, so there wasn't a correct policy. So the policy for fixing it in this case is you pull the failed drive, you take it out of the tray, you put the new drive in the tray, and you pop it back in, and the array rebuilds. I have one of these, actually I have exactly one of these arrays, and I do this every couple of months or years when a drive fails. So he did that, but yeah. No, it was drive one that failed. The question was maybe it wasn't drive one that failed. Yeah. So the question is, you know, or a comment is maybe, you know, the disk drives tend to fail when you turn it off. So in this case, he didn't turn off the array. These are hot pluggable arrays, so you can pull the SATA drive and replace it. Again, I've done this many times. In fact, that's how I upgrade the array to larger drives is you pull a drive at a time, put in a new drive, plug the drive back in, and then it rebuilds onto that, and then you pull the next drive and so on. We're all computer scientists in this room. So what you might not be able to see, because I covered it up on the top, is that there's actually four drives and four little lights, right? So that's drive one, that's drive two, that's drive three. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4. He thought the drives were numbered 0, 1, 2, 3, right? So he pulled drive one and now caused the array to have a two-drive failure. Right? This sounds really silly, but this is exactly the error that Tandem was seeing happen in their arrays. The operators were going and pulling the wrong drive. Now, this is only four drives. It gets even worse if you have a bay that has 32 drives, and it says drive 8 failed. So that's, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. No, 1, 2, 3. I mean, it's very easy to make an error, even if you know that it starts with 1 and not 0. So Tandem solution, when the drive fails, a little red light comes on. And here, you know, the red light's at the top. At Tandem, they actually put the light right on the button for the drive. So you really could not miss and pull the wrong drive. People are human, and you have to realize that, which means if there's a way for them to make a silly mistake, they're going to make that silly mistake some part of the time, and you're going to lose all your data. We'll come back to drives in just a moment. So the fault model that we're going to have here and that we think about typically with fault tolerance is we assume that faults are independent. So if we have single fault tolerance, that's a huge win. Now, note there is this big giant red asterisk because, in fact, in the real world, oftentimes faults are independent. Right? If you lose power, you're likely going to lose your air conditioning too, as we discovered at our campus data center. So you have to be careful because everything can be interdependent. If you haven't planned for all of the contingencies, you're going to run into problems. Hardware in general, we're going to assume fails fast. Right? So something goes wrong, it blue screens, it panics, you know, it stops immediately. It does not sit there silently corrupting your data. Same thing with software. We want our software to fail fast. So it's much better for our software to just abort or hang or stop responding than it is to have it keep going. Because if it keeps going, it could be corrupting data structures along the way. Now, for software, oftentimes, when something goes wrong, we can just simply reboot. We call those Heisen bugs. Those are the bugs when you kind of look at them, they go away. So we just reboot, and it goes away. So if you had a transient memory leak, then a Heisenbug, that's kind of a Heisenbug, and it'll work again. Eventually, you know, the memory leak will become a problem again, and you can reboot again. Bohr bugs, named for Niels Bohr, those are deterministic logic errors. When those occur, reboot's not going to help you. It's going to just lock up again when you reboot it. So this is where you have to go get a patch, or you have to go look at the code and fix it. Again, operations tasks are a major source of outages. Utility operations, UPS and generator maintenance. When we had the power failure on campus, our data center has generators and a week's worth of fuel. Yet they had to turn it off about an hour into the outage. Why? Because the air conditioners refused to turn on. And they talked to physical plant, and physical plant said, "We're looking at our systems, your air conditioners are running fine." And they're standing there looking at the air conditioners that are off, and the room's getting warm, and when it hit 100 something degrees, they had to pull all the plugs. So a classic operations failure. There's no reason why the data center should have gone down. But oftentimes, it's kind of amazing. You'll do maintenance on your generator, so you have to run these things like once a month or so, and you turn on the generator and your entire data center shuts down. Right? Or you switch to the UPSs to test them, and the UPSs don't take the load, and again, everything shuts down. Upgrades and configuration changes are another huge cause of failures. So if we look at hardware, this is called the bathtub curve. So hardware failures are composed of three different types of failure rates. So there's the early infant mortality rate. So this is, you buy a computer, you got a PS4 shipped to you last week, and you plug it in, and you get the flashing blue light. Right? So that's infant mortality. Burn-in can help with that. So that's where, at the factory, they plug it in, they let it run for a period of time, and they eliminate those things that are DOA. It's an interesting trade-off of doing this, because it takes a lot of time and manpower to do that burn-in. And so what most companies do now is they ship it to you and let you deal with it. Right? They try to make the quality control be high enough that the fraction of systems that fail is low enough versus the overhead associated with doing burn-in. Plus, with some things, you can't do that. You can't do burn-in with a printer, because as soon as you put a cartridge into the printer, now you have toner everywhere. So HP actually designs their printers and engineers them such that the process of building the printers has a high probability, near 100%, likelihood of you're going to plug in the printer at home and it's going to work. And even with the PS4, Sony is saying, I think the failure rates were something like 0.04%. Now, of course, if you're one of that 0.04%, you had a rather boring weekend. Then in the middle, so that accounts for this part of the curve, continuously, there are random failures. It's hardware. Especially if you have moving parts, things are going to break. And so this is just, sort of design error, I should say build errors, rather. So poor quality control will increase the sort of number of random failures that you'll have. And then as things get older, you have wear out failures. Right, so this is the yellow curve. And so this is, as a hard drive gets older, the lubricants dry out, you have vibration effects that wear the bearings, and boom, things die. Okay, dirt gets in through the filter, and you have head crashes that occur. So an online backup company, Backblaze, recently released a study. So they have 25,000 drives, and they released a study showing the failure rates that they see on those drives. Now, Backblaze is kind of interesting. Most companies that offer online backup, they contract with Hitachi or Seagate or Western Digital or a reseller to purchase enterprise class drives, which are a lot more expensive than the drives you get if you go to Fry's or someplace like that. Backblaze is a different model. They smurf their drives. They just go to the store and buy them. So they've bought a lot of drives, 25,000 of these consumer class drives. And everybody said that's a disaster because these drives will just fail like crazy. There's no quality control on those drives. So it's kind of interesting. What they see in the first year of a drive's lifespan is a 5.1% annual failure rate. So this is sort of the infant mortality curve. And this goes into the first sort of 18 months. And then there's sort of a quiescent period where they only have a 1.4% annual failure rate for a drive. And then at the start of year three, they see an 11%, 12% failure rate. Right. So that's kind of interesting. Right. Now, I mean, the first thing that's most amazing is that at the end of 4 years, almost 80% of drives survived. So even though, you know, a consumer drive that you buy might have a 1 year, or if you're lucky, a 3 year warranty, you know, gone are the 5 year warranties, those drives actually will last quite a long time. In fact, if this 11.8% curve continued, the 50% intersection point would be at about 6 years. So that means 50% of your drives will survive 6 years. That's really good for consumer drives. Now, of course, the flip side of this is all that data you're storing on your laptop hard drive or your desktop hard drive, you know, do remember that 20% of those drives failed in the first 4 years. So this is another reason to have backup. Okay. So some of the traditional techniques that people use for fault tolerance, fail-fast modules, they either work or they stop. Having spares. If you have spares, then you can have very quick recovery time. So with those NAS arrays, a lot of the enterprise arrays have extra drive bays where you just fill them with drives that aren't being used. But if one of the active drives fails, it immediately starts rebuilding onto that drive. So that way the potential for a double drive failure, the window for that is as small as possible. We'll talk about process and server pairs as a way of masking hardware and software faults. And then we've already seen transactions. Right? Give us really nice ACID semantics. If something goes wrong, just abort. Try it again. If it was a Heisen bug, that will fix it. If it's a Bohr bug, well, you know, now you're going to have repeated aborts of the transaction. You'll need some external intervention. So fail fast is part of what you need. So here's the life cycle of a hardware module. It's nice and happy, running normally. And then there's a fault. And you have to detect when that fault occurs. And once you've detected that fault, you then have a repair process where you repair it to a working state, and then you return it to active service. So what you want is, as soon as you get in the fault state, to quickly, as quickly as possible, get back to an operational state. Again, because having low unavailability will give you high availability. And the mean time to repair is critical to improving that. So again, either shortening the time to repair or increasing the time between faults is going to give you better availability. Now, you might think, if I've got one drive and that drive might fail, why don't I just simply have two drives? I can store the same data on both drives. But it turns out simple redundancy doesn't really help you that much, and it can actually hurt. So let's look at how we can make our hardware reliable. So one way to do that is to build two. You know, why build one when for twice the money you can build two? So here we have a duplex module with an output comparator. And so I can have two CPUs and then compare lockstep the output from those CPUs. And if it ever disagrees, I know one of them has failed. So in that case, if either one fails, I take this module out of service. So that's this case. So we start with both working. And in time, mean time between failure over two, because we've got two of them, either one of which can fail, we're going to go to one working. Now, as soon as we go to one working, these disagree, and our system goes down. And then time, mean time between failure to having zero working. So in this case, we end up with worse mean time between failure. Right? It didn't get better. We got two CPUs. If either one fails, the system goes down. On the other hand, if it's fail soft, which is what we can do with disk drives or with network cards, because a disk drive can tell us it's failing. Right? It can throw an ECC error or report unrecoverable data error, in which case we can take one out of service and not have to take the entire system out of service. So now it's time, mean time between failure over two, to go from two to one, and then another mean time between failure time to go to zero working. So now our mean time between failure is 1.5 times the mean time between failure of either drive. So this kind of logic, this is called the two airplane rule. Because it's called the airplane rule, because a two engine airplane is going to have twice as many problems with its engines as a single engine airplane. But would you rather fly on a one engine airplane or a two engine airplane? Right? Rather fly on the two engine airplane, because on the one engine airplane, even if that engine fails, right, you're going down, right? Whereas with two engines, you can continue on. This is why the really big planes, like the 747 and the Airbus 380, have four engines, right? Because they carry a lot of people. You want to guarantee that if you have multi-engine failures, you still can make it to a safe landing. Right? Now, one of the things they've also done on the planes is increase the mean time between failure for the engines. So, you know, you look at the GE90 engine on a 777. It has an insanely high mean time between failure. So even as a two-engine plane, it can go very, very far from land, because the probability that you'll have both engines fail far from land is extremely low. OK, so if we add repair, which of course we can't do with a plane, unfortunately, at least not midair, if we can put a module back into service quickly, then we can gain a substantial increase in the mean time between failure. So here, we have our mean time between failure over two for transitioning from two to one, and mean time between failure to transition to zero. But we also have a mean time to repair. Right? And if we can take this module that's gone out of service and bring it back into service before a mean time between failure, we'll have complete redundancy with no outage. So if, as an example, we have a 1 year mean time between failure, and a 12-hour mean time to repair, using this equation, the mean time between failure squared over 2 times the mean time to repair, we end up with a 10,000-year mean time between failure. Right, that's the probability that we'll have a failure while we're in our repair interval. So that's really good. Okay, so this is why having hot spares is a real valuable thing. Okay, any questions? So a few administrative notes. Project 3 code is due on Thursday. And we've actually changed the Project 4 design date, so the due date. So the due date was originally going to be Tuesday, and then you have a midterm on Wednesday. We figured it'd be better, given the number of points that the midterm is worth versus the number of points that the design doc is worth, that you spend more time on the midterm. So we moved it back a day to Monday the 2nd. So that really means you should be starting, after you finish your code, you should be starting for Project 3, you should be working on Project 4 right away. Any questions? Okay, we'll take a break now. Okay, let's get started again. So we can learn from some of the techniques that hardware designers use from the software standpoint. So for example, fault avoidance starts with a good and correct design. Again, this is the reason why we push you to come up with a design first before you rush out and implement it. A lot easier to understand the algorithms when you're looking at a design than it is when you're looking at raw code. In addition, there are lots of software fault tolerance techniques that you can use, some of which you already are using, like, for example, modularity. Modularity gives you isolation and fault containment, because each module can sanity check the inputs that are coming in. It can also sanity check the outputs that it's generating. Programming for failures. You know, having a programming paradigm, like, for example, MapReduce, that assumes failures are going to be very common is really good, right? Because it automatically hides those failures from you. Defensive programming. So again, you know, we're going to talk about security. This becomes very important in the security standpoint, is making sure you sanity check any data that comes from a user, right? Whether it's a local user or especially if it's a remote user. Right? This is how all those exploits and vulnerabilities occur, is because someone doesn't sanity check an input that comes in remotely over a network port or on a web server or so on. How many people have flown on an Airbus plane? Right, so if you've flown on an Airbus plane, you used inversion programming. So the aileron controls on the wings on an Airbus plane were developed, the software was developed by two different independent software teams. Given the same specification, they produce different code that does the exact same thing. And the idea was, in case one of the teams had made a logic error, you know, you'll be able to detect that. Auditors. So this is code that checks data structures in the background. So databases typically have these. They run through and they make sure that the integrity checks or some other checks still hold true. Right, so it's a great way to detect when corruption has occurred. And potentially, sometimes these auditors are capable of repairing corruption. And finally, transactions. This is something we've already talked about, but it's an easy way when there's a failure, you just simply abort, the system automatically cleans up for you. All right, now as a programmer, you might think, oh, well, you know, I'm really good about, you know, doing my tries and catches with exceptions. So here's a case where, given a file name, you know, you try and create the file. And if you can't create the file, then you print out a message saying unable to create the file along with the error message. Now, this is fine if it's your own computer and this error pops up. But imagine you're the pilot of a 787. And a could not create file name pops up on your heads-up display. Probably not a good thing. So you caught the error, but you didn't necessarily do anything useful with it. Right, so it certainly is fail fast, but in this case, definitely not the desired behavior. The desired behavior might be something like, we recreate the missing directory, and then it succeeds. Okay, so you know, this is, again, there's different ways to bulletproof. This is certainly bulletproof. It will catch the error when the directory does not exist. But at 40,000 feet, you probably want to do more than just simply report a problem. Okay, so I gave you the example of using hardware replication as at the lowest level, at the CPU level, or at the disk drive level. We can do the same thing on a server in software. So we can run, instead of one web server on our machine, two. One is our primary server, the other is our backup process. So these are one physical machine with a session, there's a web browser at the other end of this, and two processes. So from our primary web server, we're going to be pushing the state information down to our backup. So we have two separate processes with a backup ready to take over. If a fault occurs, we just switch over. Now, if it's a logic error, a Bohr bug, it's not going to fix it. Right? There's nothing we can do. We can run the backup process. It'll eventually hit the Bohr bug again, and things will stop. And your only solution is, you know, go get a new piece of code or switch your vendors. If it's a Heisen bug, we can simply restart the primary process, and now we just push the state information in the other direction. The primary becomes the backup becomes the primary. And we've restored. Okay? This is an approach that can give us very fast response time, millisecond level recovery time from a failure. And we can tolerate some hardware faults. Right? If there was memory corruption or something like that that caused the primary process to fail, we can tolerate that kind of fault. Now, what we do in a single system, we can actually do with multiple systems. So we can take our entire system and we can replicate it. Okay? Now, this can be replicated in the same data center, could be in the same rack, could be in different racks, could be in different coasts. So a lot of banks and other institutions, you know, and also a lot of the internet companies, will have multiple servers connected over the wide area. So this one might be in Sunnyvale, this one might be in Virginia. Okay? And everything is replicated. The programs, the data, the processes is all replicated. Now, logically, from the outside to as a customer, it looks like one logical system. Right? You don't log into Facebook East or log into Facebook West, even though they have multiple data centers. You log into Facebook. And then behind the scenes, they route you to the data center that's available. Right? And we push all the state over this link to the backup. So this becomes an interesting question, because when these things are far apart, there's a latency associated with that, and there's also a cost. You know, these wide area links can be very, very expensive. We might have to push many gigabits per second of traffic across that link. But assuming we have that, if the primary fails or we want to do maintenance on the primary, we can just switch over to the backup, and the backup offers service instead. Right? Now, if we have workloads that require more than one server, we need to scale. So an easy way to do this with an open source package is to use Apache Zookeeper. So how many people have used Zookeeper? Oh, just one. What did you use it for? You worked on, oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, nice. So what is Zookeeper? It's an open source Apache project that allows you to take a collection of servers and pick one to be in charge. It sounds really simple, but it's actually really complicated. When you've got a bunch of servers, you know, everybody wants to be a leader, and how do you pick it? So it does leader election. It also does group membership. So when I turn on a new server, it needs to join that group. And then those servers can all manage shared state. So you get a highly available, scalable, distributed kernel, coordination kernel, which provides you with ordered updates. So as the clients are talking to different servers, you can come up with a master ordering for all of the operations that the clients are doing. And persistence guarantees for the operations that the clients are doing. So I recommend take a look at it. It's a actually pretty easy piece of software to use. We use this in my research group. So when you're going to go large, we're talking about a very big data center, and we're talking about very large code. So now we're talking about programs that are on the scale of email, distributed calendaring, mapping applications. And your computer is a warehouse containing tens of thousands of machines or hundreds of thousands of machines. These machines, however, are a lot less reliable. So in the past, when we built a data center, we built it with mainframes, incredibly expensive, multi-million dollar computers. Today, when we build a data center, we build it out of computers that cost less than $1,000. But they're not quite as reliable as that multi-million dollar mainframe. I don't know how well you can see this picture, but this is a picture from the Computer History Museum down in the South Bay. And this is one of Google's original racks. Now, it looks kind of different from a traditional rack of computers because there's no cases. These are actually the motherboards sitting on the rails. And you might, it's kind of hard to see, but the motherboards are kind of curved. The reason why they're curved is because of these gray objects. These are the disk drives. They're sitting on top of the motherboard. So they're just kind of bowing the motherboard down. And then there's all this loose wiring. So these things had incredibly low uptimes, and Google needed a way of making that work. And this is what drove the creation of MapReduce. Because you know this is going to fail. One of these machines is going to fail during a long-running computation. So let's look at the architecture really quickly of what's inside a data center. This is one of the biggest challenges that a company faces when they want to build a 10,000 or 100,000 node data center. Huge, huge engineering issues. It's also Google's big secret sauce. They never reveal, or when they do reveal, it's when they've decommissioned a type of data center, how they do it. Facebook taking a completely different approach. They're saying, let's just open source this so everybody can do this. Why? You know, are they giving up that competitive advantage? Because they believe that if they can design super energy efficient data centers and everybody adopts that, it's good for the planet. So it's actually a good reason, but it is interesting that they're giving up, you know, the big secret sauce that is what gives Google a lot of its power. So let's look at a tier one data center, what it looks like inside of it. There's N plus one redundancy. So that means if I need one, I buy N times of it and then add one. So very, very expensive to build these. And you have multiple uplinks in terms of communication uplinks. They come into different parts of the building. Why? So if a truck hits the side of the building that has the fiber connection, it doesn't take out the entire data center because you got the other connection. Power is one of the hardest parts of it and one of the most expensive parts of it. So here's what it looks like inside a tier two data center. So this is one level below a tier one. And power to run the data center is 40% of the data center's cost. Over the lifespan of the data center, the cost for power will exceed the cost of building the data center and the cost of buying all the computers that go into the data center. So if you, you know, go to Google, their number one cost, power. This is why Google is making these huge investments in solar, why Apple is making investments in fuel cell technology, Facebook, you know. All of these companies, they locate themselves near hydro plants because you can get cheap power. Inside the data center, when you're building it, 20% of the cost of building your data center is in your power redundancy infrastructure. So going back to our tier one data center, our Miami AT&T data center, they bring into the data center two different commercial feeds at 13.8 kilovolts coming from two different substations, from two different commercial power providers. And so either provider can have an outage, they still have enough power to run the data center. It comes into a large switchgear room. The switchgear is where we can switch between commercial providers. You can also switch between commercial providers and your generators. If you lose commercial power for more than 7 seconds, you immediately start your generators. Right? Now, generators are basically big, giant diesel engines, really big diesel engines. You may have seen them around campus when we had our outage. And they have a lot of fuel. Right? It was actually kind of interesting because after class, you know, right after we had our outage the next week, Professor Candy and I were walking back past one of those generators, and what was there but a fuel truck pumping diesel into it. So these are big. Each one of these generators produces 2.5 megawatts of power. There are four of them, so that's 10 megawatts total capacity. But they take time to come up to speed. And so during that time, you rely on lead acid batteries that can provide at least 15 minutes of power. And again, it's really amazing the number of times when power goes out that the generators fail to start, all four of them. So testing, again, is very important. All that power that comes from commercial power and the generators gets fed into these large, massive motor generators. A motor generator is basically just that. It's a motor, a massive flywheel, and a generator. And the idea is that the massive flywheel provides you with high inertia. And so you can use this as a way of getting extremely clean power out of it. If there are sags or dips or spikes or undervoltage, the motor generator can tolerate all of those because of the incredible inertial mass and give you very, very clean power. So all of this is incredibly expensive. You have to buy, you know, there's only a few companies that make generators over a megawatt in size, and there's a long waiting list to buy those because everybody's building big data centers. So companies like Google and Facebook have been looking at alternate approaches. One of the approaches they've been looking at is not having generators, So if a data center is going to go down, I just shift the workload somewhere else. And not having big, massive UPSs. Instead, they just put a battery with each rack. And they distribute within the data center power at much at 277 volts. And so they step it down. And by doing this, they're able to reduce the site losses that would happen with having a central UPS. They're also able to reduce the distribution losses because they can convert to 48 volt centrally and then send around 48 volt each component. So it is just a taste of the challenges associated with building a data center from the power engineering side of it. Lots of innovation that goes on in that space. Now, there are many, many different commercial providers that offer cloud computing, and this is the great part. There's Amazon, there's Google Compute Engine, there's Azure, there's Rackspace, and they give you inexpensive virtual machines. So Amazon will sell you a virtual machine for as cheap as one penny per hour. So it's like buying a server, except you don't have to buy the server, and whenever you're done with the server, you turn it off. If you need more servers, you buy more servers an hour. So it's a very nice model, and competition is great. It's driving down the prices. Every 6 to 8 months, Amazon announces a price drop. Google Compute Engine, they roll it out, they announce huge savings in prices, Amazon follows suit. Now is the best time to be graduating. I mean, it doesn't get any better. If you're gonna go and do a startup, this is the ideal time. Because it used to be you had to go to the venture capitalist and say, give me $2 million so I can build out a data center with several hundred computers because I have this really cool app. And I know we're going to get millions of users. And the VCs would look at you and say, yeah, I think maybe, yeah. And then you build it and, 100 of your friends show up and use the app. And you have this $2 million data center. Not very good. So VCs don't like that anymore. They love this model because now if a million users show up, I spool up 1,000 VMs. And if those users go away because of, the dig effect or the slashdot effect, I spin down those instances, and so I can perfectly track my expenditures with my demand. And eventually you reach a crossover point, perhaps, where it becomes feasible for you to go and build your own data center. But you can push that out as far as possible. Now, to make all of this work, we need a model that can let us program in an instance where we might have failures. And this is what MapReduce really made possible. Right. MapReduce made it possible to work on petabytes of data per day, many tens of petabytes of data per day, for novice programmers. The time to come up to scale in programming at Google is only a week or two. And now you're dealing with thousands of computers and petabytes of data. When MapReduce was announced, which was now almost a decade ago, people were just shocked. They were like, 20 petabytes in one day? We don't have 20 petabytes of data in our company, let alone be able to manipulate that data. But when you're a company like Google, you make all your money off of figuring out exactly what your customers are doing, your users are doing, and targeting ads, you need to process massive amounts of data. Same thing for Facebook, right? They're processing many tens of petabytes a day using MapReduce, and Yahoo, too. Very simple programming model, key value. Everybody here has written MapReduce programs. But what you may not have seen is the fault tolerance side of it. So if a task crashes, we just simply run it again on a different node. If a node crashes, we relaunch the tasks that were running on that node. The fundamental assumption here is your tasks have to be deterministic and side effect free. So idempotent is important. If a task is going slowly, we just simply launch a second copy of that task. Very simple. This is really important for getting good performance out of these large clusters. Because in these large clusters, I may have a machine that's starting to fail. And if that machine's starting to fail, it's going to run slowly. And so I want to make sure I can launch a task elsewhere and have it finish faster. But there are many other distributed applications that you can run in these environments. Web applications, services, they have many complex moving parts, many interdependencies that are often hidden. So here's a website that's kind of fun to go and read. It's called analysiscasestudyblogspot.com. And they have all sorts of comments about outages and the causes of the outages. So some of these occurred, they always occur at the worst possible time. And so Microsoft had an Xbox Live and Azure outage that occurred on December 28th until December 31st. Right, so right after Christmas, after everybody got those Xbox 360s, oh well. but they're not the only one, right, not to pick on them. Amazon had an outage December 24th. So you've got all those little kids screaming for their presents, and you're trying to keep them happy with watching some Netflix, SpongeBob SquarePants or something like that, and Netflix is down. Right? There were thousands of very angry parents. And that was caused by a problem with EC2, the elastic load balancers. They loaded an incorrect configuration. Then during the repair process, they made it worse. They didn't make it better. And so that caused the outage to be longer. That's why it's very important to have good repair processes. Again, Amazon's not the only one. You know, Google and Microsoft have had email outages caused by updates that went wrong. And then Dropbox had an outage, undetermined what the cause of it was. This is kind of the worst, right? You really do want the exact cause to be determined because you want to make sure it's not going to happen again, especially if you rely on Dropbox for some mission-critical part of your company. So one of the lessons that Netflix learned from having lots of angry parents when Amazon went down is you need to break your systems purposefully to see whether they can recover or not. So they introduced publicly this thing called the Chaos Monkey. And what does the Chaos Monkey do? It runs around the Amazon data center killing Netflix virtual machines. Now, most of the time, nothing happens. Because that's what's supposed to happen, right? A failure occurs, and it just transparently routes to somewhere else. But sometimes, things go horribly wrong. Right? And then that becomes a learning lesson that they have to go and fix. Now, after the Amazon outage that occurred, so as an example, there was an April 2011 EC2 outage that affected a lot of startups, you know, some of the biggest. Netflix had no impact. But after that big outage in December, now they have the super chaos monkey. So they've replicated, Amazon's replicated across multiple data centers. The super chaos monkey now kills an entire data center and sees what happens. And again, most of the time, nothing happens. Completely invisible to the customer. And occasionally it's visible, and that points out, you know, here's a single point of failure that we hadn't identified. Very interestingly, they use Cassandra as their data store, and they do a dump of Cassandra into Amazon long-term storage periodically. And one of the important things that they just started doing is taking one of those Cassandra dumps and putting it in Google Compute Engine. Why? Just in case Amazon has some massive failure that should corrupt their long-term storage. They have all of their customer data somewhere else. So very important thing to think about when you're doing a startup is think about the third-party providers and how many of them you have. So the last thing I want to say is you can add geographic diversity. So here's this is kind of an old picture, but it's one of the few pictures you can find of supposedly where all Google's data centers are. And you can see they put them on multiple continents. Right? They do this for a variety of reasons. One is they want to be close to the customer, but the other is they want to be able to tolerate things like transatlantic fiber cut because someone's dredging where they shouldn't be dredging or something like that. And so geographic diversity is a way to help reduce single points of failure. I put the big asterisk and I say reduce instead of eliminate because there are still services that you will find are global. So for example, Google and Amazon have had failures because of authentication service failures, where Google had a failure that was due to a load balancer problem that took down one load. They were doing an upgrade on the load balancers. It took down one load balancer, and then it rippled across and took out all the load balancers. And so Google went, dark for a period. Yeah, question? Do I think there will be servers on the moon? So, I would have said no because of the bandwidth issues, but NASA just did a study where they are sending using fiber, a very high bandwidth connection to one of the orbiters on the moon. So aside from latency issues, I could easily imagine, you know, someone launching, you know, a few petabytes worth of storage up to the moon and then doing rsync over a laser link. I mean, you know, it's moon storage, not quite cloud storage. But, you know, disaster recovery. If something major happens, you know, we get a meteor that strikes or something like that, it'd be nice to have a backup somewhere else. So, in summary, today we focused on reliability, integrity, availability, but there's also security, right? Even if your system is up, but the hackers are running around deleting all your data inside the network, or you know this ransomware that goes and encrypts all your data and then demands Bitcoin payments, your system's not very available. We looked at how hardware and software fault tolerance can increase the mean time between failure and simultaneously reduce the mean time to repair. So we want to make it longer between failures and make it shorter to recover from a failure. We build reliable systems today from unreliable components. This is perhaps, you know, one of the biggest changes that we've seen in the last decade, is a shift from expensive, reliable components as our building block to very inexpensive, unreliable components. We see that with Google and others. We see that with Backblaze going out and buying consumer drives instead of server drives. The key thing, you always have to assume that whatever could go wrong actually will go wrong, because it will eventually, and usually at the most inopportune time. So if you plan for that and you design your systems around that, then those won't be outages. Still, no matter how well you design your system, there are always going to be blind spots. And so I really think, you know, something like a Chaos Monkey is really cool. And they open sourced it. You can go download the Chaos Monkey and try it against a bunch of VMs and see, you know, whether your service really could survive losing multiple components. Make your operations bulletproof. So again, operations after software are one of the biggest sources of unavailability. And so, you know, remember, it's not always Uber hackers that are your operators. So make sure when you're going to do a configuration change or an upgrade, you know, do it during the middle of the day with all hands on deck. You know, most companies like to do it in the middle of the night, and then something goes wrong, and everybody's asleep and away. And then apply replication at all levels, including globally or maybe even on the planetary scale will help. Any questions? Okay. Etta Kappa Nu was supposed to be here today, and I don't know what happened. So I guess we'll have to do our course survey at a different day. So with that, I am done if there are no more questions.